Right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the 29th meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome members, welcome our witnesses and welcome visitors in the gallery. And can I remind everyone please to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the sound equipment. We have apologies this morning from Dennis Robertson, and we are joined by Bruce Crawford as a substitute. Item one on the agenda, can I ask if members are content that we take item four, a discussion on our future work programme, in private? Yep. That is agreed. Thank you. Item two on the agenda, we are continuing to take evidence in relation to our pre-budget scrutiny of the Scottish Government's 2016-17 budget. And we're focusing this morning on tourism, and I'd like to welcome joining us from Visit Scotland, Dr. Mike Cantlay, Chairman, and Malcolm Roughead, Chief Executive, and from the Scottish Tourism Alliance, Marc Crothall, who is the Chief Executive. Welcome to you all. Before we get into questions, I think, Dr. Cantlay, you want to say something by way of a brief opening statement?
Yeah, I was going to give you just the latest update, as it were, on where we are in 2015. And clearly, 2014 was the big year, and you've been through the success of 14 in terms of the results, etc. So I thought I would just update you where we are as we head towards the end of 15, and information is coming in as to how we performed in 2015. In many senses, 14 was 14. It was the big year. But 14 wasn't so much about 14. 14 was a catalyst, along with the winning years 12, 13 and 14, to kick Scottish tourism into the second part of the decade. But 2015 was always going to be interesting, because the reality is that many countries that host major sporting events do incur an immediate draft after they've hosted them. Media attention moves on, etc. So 2015 was always going to be interesting, and interesting to see if we maintained the momentum. In particular, as we started into 2015, the environment looked particularly difficult. It was a period where international visitors into the UK were taking a dip, in particular London. And in particular, the big issue was exchange rates. So as we head into 15, we saw some profound shifts in exchange rates. The euro in particular moved about 15% in the early part of the year, that kind of selling period for us as well. So suddenly Scotland became 15% more expensive for our European visitors, and of course works both ways. Europe became 15% cheaper for UK visitors considering whether to holiday with us or abroad. And I'd say some of the other currencies were more difficult. And then as we got into the year, we had weather, which I don't need to tell you about because you all remember, in spring and summer. So we had all the constituents, as it were, of what you'd expect to be quite a difficult time. And of course, tourism goes in these cycles. And in a sense, our objective was, yes, to get growth. That's what the winning years was all about. But to get the cycle moving so that instead of flatlining, it was going up, even in the context of the peaks and troughs that we have. So 2015 was going to be a fascinating year. Now, we only have the official statistics for the first 6 months, and you have those. And actually, they were very encouraging. I would anticipate the second half being slightly softer. Primarily, apart from anything else, we were comparing against the big events in 2014. But as we head to the end of the year, by and large, it's been a much better year than many had anticipated, and in a sense, perhaps a better year than we might have deserved, given the movements in exchange rates in particular. So here we are. It looks as though we've the industry who have really gone about 2015 trying to capitalize on 14 and look to the future, better organized than ever before, with, of course, the TS 2020 vision. It would appear we're in good shape to march on, and I'm sure that will be part of the debate this morning, in particular as exchange rates look to be a little easier for us in the next period. So we're in good shape as we sit and looking forward to the second part of the decade.
Okay.
Starter for 10.
Thank you very much. I don't know, Marc Crothall, you want to add anything to that, or just happy to go into questions?
No, I think I'd echo Mike, what Mike said. The mood from the industry has been very positive, and I think surprised some, perhaps. There's a lot of confidence out there, but there's no complacency, I think.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we've got about an hour and maybe 15 minutes or so for this session. Can I ask members if they would keep their questions short and to the point? And answers as short and to the point as possible would be helpful. And perhaps members could initially direct their questions to one panel member, and then if you want to come in response to a question directed to somebody else, just catch my eye and I'll bring you in as best I can as time allows. I wonder if I could just start off asking about the Scottish Government's budget. We're in a slightly unusual position this year in terms of budget scrutiny because the budget has not been published. It's not published until the 16th of December. So we are taking evidence in anticipation of the budget. And with that in mind, I wonder if I could ask you, ask both organisations, maybe start with you, Marc Crothall from SDA. What is it your members would like to see in the budget? If you were making an ask to the Finance Secretary today, what are the top lines that you want to see addressed in the government's budget? Sorry, can I just say you don't need to touch the buttons?
No, fine.
It's all controlled remotely.
Great. So. Automatic, we like digital. And on that note, we've set out in our policy agenda, actually, which we issued on the 30th of September, really some sort of key headlines, one of which I suppose is the main piece around continued investment in the digital infrastructure. And I think, you know, taking on board the future approach by Visit Scotland around the marketing strategies, it's absolutely essential we're able to get more of our industry online, connected, and capable of using digital. Tomorrow there's the launch of a 1.2 million training program to assist the industry in getting better skilled in that process. So certainly we can't stop there, and that needs to continue. We're absolutely all behind a much needed strong budget for Visit Scotland to continue to market. Although we've enjoyed the benefits of 14 and a good year in 15, again, the complacency piece can't be there. So we have to continue to be aggressive in the marketplace, and therefore the funds need to be made available to do that. We had some good discussion and have had ongoing discussion around the roles of destination organisations in terms of a funding support scheme for DMOs, for key DMOs that provide a good support network, not just to do the marketing aspect of that particular destination, but also to deliver on a number of other initiatives in the local community for the benefit of the wider economy. So, investment, continued investment for scaling the workforce, etc. Those, I would say, are the headlines that we've identified. We're going through a midterm review of the strategy at the moment, and again, they seem to be the same themes to address what are being identified as the big game change challenges.
Okay, thank you. And maybe ask the same question to Visit Scotland.
Well, I'll let Malcolm answer the question, other than to just highlight what is a significant issue with the CSR, which is, of course, in terms of marketing, we work closely with Visit Britain, and they don't know their budget yet either. They will know next week, so we understand, which is a key feature, considering we do rely on them in certain markets. But Malcolm, in terms of Visit Scotland?
Certainly from our perspective, what we'd like to do is actually build on the momentum that's been highlighted. So that would mean looking at continuing the marketing activity, and Mark's alluded to the changes that are about to come through the system. It's also about looking at channel shift efficiencies, which we've been moving, as you'd be aware, from a pure broadcast approach to much more usage of digital channels, and that allows us to increase the reach and get out there to a global audience, albeit Visit Britain is a key component of that. So we'll watch, you know, what happens next week in terms of their own budget and have to realign accordingly. You'll be aware that we've relaunched the Scotland the Perfect Stage strategy. In fact, a little plug for the conference on the 3rd of December, if anyone would like to come along, you'd be most welcome. But again, I think that's about building on the capability and the credibility that Scotland has in terms of hosting world events, and we'd like to continue that. But we're realistic and we're pragmatic, and certainly over the last sort of 5 years, we've been trying to become as efficient as possible, and that should get us into a place where we're able to respond to whatever comes our way.
Okay, thank you for that, and I'm sure a number of the issues you've touched on we want to explore in terms of the session. You touched, Marc Crothall, on the issue of digital infrastructure. I think Joan McAlpin wanted to ask some questions around that.
Yes, particularly in terms of digital connectivity, I wondered what problems the tourism industry faced in the areas where there isn't good digital connectivity. And if you could address maybe the issues of broadband and mobile separately.
I think the consumer trend is that people are choosing to search and buy by using tablet. I mean, more people own a toothbrush than they own a mobile phone. And there'll be more mobile phones in the world than there will be population. So that in itself tells a story. To be competitive, you have to be able to, be able to place your product online and market that through the VisitScotland.com sites, have online booking facilities. And where you're restricted in doing that, then clearly there you are missing out. We have also made clear in our position statement in our policy agenda that from a price competitiveness perspective, the UK is currently ranked 140 out of 141, albeit there is a strong skew towards the London cost base or cost centre. However, a quality of experience, high quality, value for money, memorable experience is what, the tourism strategy is saying. It's our ambition, ensuring that we deliver that. And what is now a basic requirement or acceptance is not there. And, Scotland has the worst 3G coverage in the UK. 46% of visitors were unsatisfied with Wi-Fi availability. We have to respond to that to live up to and deliver on the expectations of the modern traveller. And business tourism in particular, where you take on a sector that itself delivers 1.9 billion to the bigger picture, in attracting some of those big international conferences and conventions, which the country is now very equipped to do, when you don't have what is basic broadband or a reasonable pace of broadband and mobile connectivity, that in itself puts us on the back foot to be competitive.
I suppose these major conferences in big cities wouldn't be affected. It would be out with their big cities, she would be talking about.
I've driven from Glasgow today. I lost the phone signal three times. Stephen Leckie, who is our chair up in Crewford, I think, his the best thing that came out of the Ryder Cup for him was having 4G from being one to none and not being able to be connected. But it is the rural parts. Business tourism, I'm up in Inverness tonight to promote the Business Tourism for Scotland, Think Scotland, Think Conference initiative. And there you have infrastructure and properties who are very capable of attracting large-scale conferences, and they need to have, the technology and the connectivity to do that.
Yeah. Has any calculation been made in terms of cost terms, how much we're losing out financially because of this?
Not that I'm aware of, unless you've said anything.
Yeah. If you want me to, I'll just come back on some of those points. I've been going around the country for the last 6 to 9 months talking to groups from South, and Monday I was up in Shetland, and the one topic that comes up at every group is digital connectivity and competitiveness. I think it's more in that framework. And I guess there's sort of five elements to that. There's the hardware, then there's the capacity, then there's the capability, then there's the ability to convert business that's generated, which I think is the point that you're making. And then there's also about using digital in terms of communications. So in terms of the hardware, obviously the broadband rollout is happening. That's being managed by HI on behalf of everybody. But you really need that in place before you can actually address the mobile issue, which is absolutely fundamental because more and more people are using mobile. And part of the problem that you have is that we're actually building on a legacy system. It's not like some of the old Eastern European countries like Estonia, where they didn't have, you know, the lines in place. They just went straight to mobile. And you also see that in India, which is actually probably one of the most advanced mobile business-enabled countries in the world. So, you know, we're dealing with that and getting that in place. Capacity is also not just about download, it's about being able to upload. So businesses actually raise the issue that, you know, it's the upload capacity issue that they're concerned about. Capability is very much about skills, and a lot of the programs that are out there are actually aimed at what I would call the digitally included. So it's about enhancing your skills. But what's coming through more and more is that there's a vast amount of people out there who are digitally excluded. And I think, you know, we need to actually look at how do we address that? How do we make those businesses competitive? And you asked about, is there any stats? Well, we have 9,000 businesses listed on VisitScotland.com. 30% of those businesses are able to transact online. That means that somewhere like 6,300 businesses are missing out on the opportunity that's provided to them because they can't transact online. And as Mark says, you know, people who come online want to book online. It's as simple as that. There's 64% of all bookings globally are made online. So it's a huge opportunity, but it's a challenge as well, because we've actually got to make sure that the programs that are in place are bespoke and allow people, A, to overcome some of the technical issues, but also there's a certain amount of a fear factor, and I guess the analogy is if you're sitting next to a geek and you're an absolute beginner, you're going to be slightly intimidated. Likewise, if you're a geek sitting next to a beginner, you're not actually going to advance your own skills you know, the way that you would want. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done in making sure that the amount of activity that is generated out there, and there's a lot of good activity, but it is actually focused in the right areas. And then you get to the slightly more esoteric area, which is about communications and how do you use search engine optimization, how do you maximize the listings, how do you use dynamic content. But that's kind of slightly further down the line in terms of capability.
Financially, is there for smaller tourist businesses, is there a challenge in terms of obviously setting up the website and that kind of thing? And I take it that that's quite a major investment. And what support is available for those kind of businesses?
A lot of business support through people like Business Gateway and others and the enterprise companies. The actual cost of investment nowadays in that type of technology has come down significantly. There are many, many web booking engine providers out there. I won't name any of them, obviously, because there's plenty available. But also, if you look at the software packages that are available, the cost of those, like everything, over time, you know, actually starts to diminish. So they have to look at it as an investment, and that investment will be repaid time and time again.
Can I just go back to Mark, the point that you made earlier about the visitor experience and the expectations of visitors to be able to go online and use mobile phones? In particular, I'm talking about mobile phones. Is the poor visitor experience around digital connectivity affecting our returners?
I would say, you know, when you look at the future generation of traveller, and it's the young traveller, you know, I've got young kids, and I know that, you know, a choice of going somewhere if there isn't a connection makes my life a bit of a challenge, and we might not go back to that place again. And I think, you know, this is about the future and how we look to the millennial traveller as well, and that where, you know, TripAdvisor, we had a speaker at our conference back in October, and things like searching for you know, the best restaurants. You want to spend your money wisely, and you want to make the best considered choice, and using technology and being able to access those applications and get online and make a considered choice there and then is really important. If you're not able to do that, then I think people may not return. If I can just pick up on another couple of things Malcolm was just saying, the £1.2 million training program that's being launched tomorrow does address the three sort of tiers of capability. We've been conscious of the working group of making sure that, you know, it's not all targeted to those who are already engaged. So the ones who are perhaps scared and maybe a bit more mature, and we do have a lot of slightly more mature operators in the rural parts, lifestyle providers who technology wasn't around. And interestingly enough, you know, in the tourism strategy, when it was first scripted in 2011, the word digital was only written into it three times. So when you look at the pace of change, it's quite significant. And as far as the cost for businesses to set up, as STA, one of our key objectives is to try and make access or easier cost benefits for our membership and for the wider industry. And we've been working very closely with Microsoft and other partners to bring a product to the membership at a very warehouse rate, which will enable businesses to equip themselves and get themselves set up. And it's distilling that myth that it is expensive, because it's not. And I believe, I think when we met with Bruce Crawford a couple of weeks ago, there's a fund of that can be accessed as well. So to assist the small business around the digital piece. But it's portraying and getting that message out there that you have to get online, don't be afraid of it, and it's not expensive, and there is a support in place to enable you to get going.
Sure. I can see that, you know, you're able to do that kind of thing, invest in training and invest in encouraging companies to get online. When it comes to 3G coverage for the user, for mobile phones, there's not a great deal you can do if it's not there. It's really up to the mobile operators and Ofgem. What would you like to see happen, to given that it's regulated at a UK level, to improve that for Scotland? What do you think needs to change?
Well, there needs to be more collective working and collaborative working between the providers to get them to recognise that, you know, this is the way forward. And I think licensing and all the other things that go with that have to be considered. There is obviously an ability to access and create applications without coverage, and technology is being developed there, but it's the pace of change needs to accelerate further.
The licensing regime needs to change.
Without being fully aware of the detail behind that, I think the conversations of getting the providers more on the page and quicker is important.
Supplementary. Just quickly, following up on some of that question about joining up, I've raised with the Scottish Government a question around the broadband discount voucher scheme that the UK Government ran, and which I think 3,000 businesses in Scotland have benefited from. It has ceased. It was clearly a good scheme for assisting businesses to upgrade to better and faster broadband. It's not been clear to me from the responses I've had from ministers that there's a particular joining up between Scottish and UK initiatives. Is this something that is apparent from the tourism point, from the tourist industry point of view? Do you have a sense that there's good schemes running, but they're not particularly connected with each other?
I think there's lots of good things out there. I think trying to find some of them and get through, lots of detail to access, whether it be funding support for anything, is at times difficult. But also, getting through it and using technology to get through it makes it a lot easier. And it comes back to time as well. So trying to, again, one of the key sort of objectives of working very much, collaboratively with the enterprise agencies and the government around the table is, how can we cut some of this multitude of pages out of the system to be able to give a more direct access and create a greater awareness of what's on offer, because I think there is plenty out there.
So would it be fair to say that one of the things you'd like to see going forward is a better joining up between, or a better clarity for
I think anything that businesses. makes it clearer to industry and easier for industry to access to gain the support is always going to be beneficial. Time is of the essence. We'll work much harder. Clearing the reams of pages and things before you get to that is something that is key, and probably better spent and better money spent for everybody.
Okay, we'll move on. I'll bring in Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much. I wanted to move on to the Scotland's National Tourism Strategy, Scotland Tourism 2020. And it says that it's got a target of generating an annual overnight visitor spend equating to an additional $1 billion or more by 2020. And Scottish Tourism Alliance's written submission says we're currently not on track to meet this target. Looking back on the corporate plan of Visit Scotland 2011-2014, it said tourism is an £11 billion sector. Your 2013-2016 corporate plan said that the visitor economy is estimated at £11.6 billion, and that was a Deloitte report in 2013 prior to the bumper year of 2014. So if we're not on target to achieve this additional $1 billion in 2020, why are we not on target, and what do we need to do in order to get back on target?
Can I just, firstly, I just need to differentiate the figure you're talking about there in terms of $6 billion or so is actually overnight expenditure, as opposed to the visitor economy, which is the gross economic activity generated by visitor expenditure. So,
but presumably part of that growth would have been overnight visitor
expenditure. Yeah, and I'll answer that in just a second. But just to throw in another figure, the Scottish Government's latest figure actually on the visitor economy is $12 billion. So there has been even more progress since that $11.6 billion that Deloitte's came out with. Mike talked about the numbers this year in 2015 and the positive underlying trend that's been there. And certainly the UK visitor expenditure, overnight visitor expenditure to the end of July shows 27% growth year on year by value. So if you extrapolate that forward, then the likelihood is that we will come to a point of about £5 billion by the end of this year for overnight expenditure. That then means to get to the bottom end of the scale that's in the 2020 document, you need to grow roughly 1.6% compound annually. I'm not that pessimistic. I actually think we can do that.
Okay. My question to follow on from that was about occupancy rates, room occupancy rates. And I understand that 2014 was a bumper year, but looking at the occupancy rates for, say, the last 3 years, it was 65% in 2012, 68% in 2013, 70% in 2014, which is substantially higher than where we were in 2000 or 2001. So, you know, in terms of occupancy rates, if we want to hit this level of spend, what percentage of occupancy rate are we needing to try and hit? And therefore, is it a realistic target?
Yeah, unfortunately, it's not quite as binary as that because of the fluctuation in terms of the type of accommodation offer. So you've got, you know, a proliferation of travel lodges and Premier Inns, etc., which are coming onto the market. For me, actually, it's not about the number of rooms, it's about the value of those rooms. So there'll be some areas of Scotland where actually you're looking at yield maximisation rather than occupancy. There'll be other areas where quite clearly we're looking actually at getting volume in before that you can then move up in terms of premiumisation, to use that horrible term. So it is a mix, it's not quite as clear-cut.
And do we have enough capacity, and is that capacity in the right places?
Two questions. Do we have enough capacity currently? Yes. In the future, probably not, in terms of the right type of capacity. Good example of that is we have 2,850 five-star bedrooms. If we are actually going to make a success in the international markets, the demand is going to grow in that particular area. They're currently running at somewhere in the region at the moment of over 90%. So, you know, it's not about volume in that respect. It's actually about growing that overall segment. And that means we need to encourage inward investment, but in the places where the demand is.
And how would we go about generating international hotel chains to actually start investing in parts of Scotland that need that investment?
Well, two sides to that. Firstly, we work very closely with Scottish Development International, which is you know, that relationship's a very positive one, and you've seen a number of projects, whether they go through or not. You know, the point is, those projects have come to almost fruition. Secondly, you have the National Tourism Development Framework, which brought together all 32 local authorities to look at where are the gaps in terms of provision, and also where is the investment being made. What I'd like to see is that actually become a bit more of a dynamic planning tool, so that actually we can overlay the trends and we can look at where estimated demand will come from, which actually means that we can focus our efforts, because we're going to have to going forward, in a much more productive manner, which means we get the investors on board that are going to make the difference.
Okay, thanks so much.
Okay, thank you. Brilliant.
Thank you. Good morning. I wonder if I can just follow on the question, one of the questions that Gordon raised, and a particular reference to, I understand the explanation that Malcolm made in terms of day trips and what have you, but also the concession that STA raised in terms of not being on track to achieve their tourism numbers. How do you relate to each other, Visit Scotland and STA? Is there any overlap? Is there any overlap of spending? Is there any overlap of objectives?
Well, we're all absolutely around the same page. We have the same...
That's what concerns me in terms of duplication. I mean, are you on the same page in terms of operations, or are the lines of...
We are not a marketing agency. We do no consumer-faced marketing at all. We are there to support help cascade the Visit Scotland initiatives, particularly around the focus years, and try and encourage the industry to get on board the various campaigns. We work very closely with Visit Scotland on the growth fund application piece, the various steering groups. And when it comes to dovetailing into the strategic thinking for the future planning around Tourism 2020 and where we want to go, the marketing element of the Tourism 2020 strategy is driven by the Visit Scotland agenda, as is the events and festivals work stream. And Malcolm, I thought Mike alluded to the perfect stage document. So that becomes the agenda.
Can I just ask Mark, because one of the draft priorities in your strategy is internationalisation. And I just wonder how you're capitalising on, you know, the priorities that may or may not have been set in terms of internationalisation from Visit Scotland. I mean, 85% of our visitors still come from south of the border.
Yep. And the tourism
unhappily, not unhappily, I'm glad they come. But I mean, in terms of our internationalisation inquiry that we carried out, our objectives internationally, I know a lot of good things have happened, but how is that dovetailing?
We are not, you know, the tourism strategy itself spells out very clearly that, you know, 80% of that marketplace is still the domestic market. So nobody is sort of saying that, you know, the international market is the be-all and end-all. Yes, we need to prepare ourselves to go and get it. There's a lot of reference to China, particularly in and around Edinburgh. So part of the strategic work plan that's being developed by the work streams out of the strategy is about how do we equip ourselves best to be able to service those international visitors as and when they come. So, and again, you know, the future marketing focus around specific key audiences, again, all of the activity that we sort of drive forward and through, whether it be the skills investment plan or looking at the actual work streams within the various asset groups, will be concentrated on those particular markets that have been identified by Visit Scotland and will be targeted as the ones that will provide, you know, the focus.
I'll then ask Mike and Malcolm. Last year there was an additional £5 million funding put in the budget for air route marketing and golf legacy. Air route marketing clearly is important in terms of the internationalisation aspect. So I wonder if you can tell us what is actually, how that has developed, that £5 million spend. And also, if you've qualified what might happen or what will happen when APD is reduced and eventually vanquished forever.
Right. Well, there's about eight things to do there. So let's just go back a bit, because what I find reassuring is thinking back to my early appearances at the committee in 2010, 2011, which were characterized by two things, really. Number one was growth, because there wasn't any. There wasn't how much growth. It was, there isn't growth, so how do we get it going?
But secondly, one of the key features and one of the reasons I was keen to get involved in 2010 was there was huge friction around as to who does what role Visit Scotland has, where the industry was. We were dealing with the aftermath of the area tourist boards being amalgamated in Visit Scotland, etc., etc. And one of the things that I remember we went out to make very clear at that point is that in the end of the day, Visit Scotland is here as a government agency, as an economic development agency, to deliver for industry, to deliver in particular bits industry can't. That's why we're here. If industry can do it for themselves, then, you know, our role is diminished or nil. And the difficulty we had at that point was we didn't have coordination in the industry to express that viewpoint. And what we have today and why industry is so much more comfortable with progress, and I'm not saying that of VS or other government agencies or even STE, but just it's so much clearer as to where we are, mm-hmm. is because we have an STE who has a clear vision and a ambition, and industry can speak for itself without, in a sense, Visit Scotland and other government agencies can get on with answering these points. I think the question you didn't ask, Marc, but I can't remember this myself. How many staff do you have?
We have core team four. There you go. And,
there we go. So we have four staff. So in the end of the day, as an organisation, STA is limited in terms of what they're going to actually physically do in terms of what is a relatively small organisation. But in terms of its role as a catalyst, pulling together industry and defining that vision, it's hugely important, and it's made life so much easier. If I go on and answer your specific questions, I'll do air, and Malcolm can do golf because he's a better golfer than me. In terms of air and lift, as it's called in the industry, it's absolutely crucial. We've made huge progress over the last few years. We have almost 100 international air routes, new air routes into Scotland that have come to one airport or another along the way. And that has been very significant in helping Scottish tourism. One of the biggest issues, in fact, if you were to say to me, come on, what is the real big issue in this area? Good question. surrounds London. And you'll say, oh, here we go, we're going into runways and all the rest of it. Well, actually, it's a shorter term issue in terms of the movement in the marketplace, in terms of the use of London, because there are many markets that are used to using London to get to Scotland, and the market is changing dramatically. And in particular, the recent period, of course, we've just lost Virgin's connecting service to London, and that was something in the region of 300 international connecting seats a day between Edinburgh and Aberdeen. That's a lot of seats. And in particular, it's not just about the access, it's about the networks and alliances and how the airlines work together. And also it's about the pricing models, because whenever there's a capacity restriction, it tends to push pricing up. So pricing and value in air travel, in particular medium and long haul, has become a big issue for us. And Scotland rates as being quite expensive from some markets to access from medium and long haul markets. Not all, but some. And it's an issue that we're working very hard on. And in a sense, I suppose the kind of route development initiative is working more towards broader themes of connectivity, where it's about not just point to point, it's about ensuring that we're properly plugged into the airline networks and alliances to ensure that customers can get here easily and affordably from wherever they are in the world.
Have you assessed the impact of APD?
Forgot to mention APD. Well, clearly, on the value issue, APD reduction would help hugely. We're hugely supportive of anything that makes Scotland more competitive. And value, in particular, with the issues that I explained in terms of exchange rate, is a core issue at the moment, as I say. So a reduction in APD would be very welcome. And the airlines and the travelling public have made very clear that would be very welcome to them too.
Thank you.
Golf.
On the golf front, obviously the legacy around the Ryder Cup continues in terms of investment in the major events, and those are secured all the way through to 2020 and beyond. I think the the biggest challenge for us is to make sure that the activity that we run in conjunction with the likes of NBC and others, you know, is maximised here in this country, not just in terms of visitors, but also in terms of making sure that trickles down into clubs, that the clubs become more proficient, shall I say, in business practices. And the Solheim Cup, I think, will give an extra fillip to that. We're absolutely delighted that we've managed to secure that for Scotland. It's also about in terms of how do we position those events, and you'll be aware there's been a lot of conversations around the tour in terms of taking the Scottish Open as one of the beacon events on the programme, which would attract obviously the major players that are on the European tour and those based in the States who perhaps don't come to Europe as much as we'd like them to. And again, that's not just about the immediate economic benefit, it's also about the knock-on effect and trying to get kids out there and into golf, which then feeds its way back through the system, and hopefully we end up with an inclusive sport that is affordable for everybody.
But you and I had a conversation just last week about opening up the Scandinavian route to, dare I say it, Prestwick, but also going on to Ireland, creating that Western European. Will you consider that and take that forward in terms of, I know you've talked to Ryanair before, but it doesn't just have to be Ryanair.
No, that's right. And there's a couple of elements to it. There's the tour operators themselves to make sure that they have the programmes in place to get the support that they're looking for. And then there's obviously how do we get them here. And, you know, again, you look at the success going back to aviation of the landing, to forgive the pun, of the Aberdeen-Reykjavik route. And I think, you know, that in itself will help. So, you know, we're able to take people not just into the central belt, but also, and again, with BA now flying to Inverness, so we can take them further afield. And that's got to be a good thing, you know, for the rural economies, which are pretty fragile.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I've got three members who want to come in with supplementaries. I'm assuming it's on the air passenger duty initially. Start with Patrick Harvey.
Thanks very much. Good morning. You didn't mention APD in your written evidence, but it's come up in discussion here. Your written evidence, though, does make clear that aviation levels have continued to increase. It's clear, isn't it, that APD doesn't act to prevent aviation levels from increasing?
Well, I think it's a factor, but we've been obviously successful in attracting more people to come and see us with aviation of that year.
APD hasn't stopped that from happening.
No, APD hasn't stopped it, but it's well known in the entire trade, and I don't just mean the airline industry, I mean the travel and leisure industry, the issue of APD in the UK, and it's deemed to be a barrier. For sure.
It's widely spoken of in those terms,
exactly.
But the figures do show that aviation levels
That's
have increased.
That's perfectly fair. Yeah.
Given that we are talking about the most environmentally destructive form of travel that's available, and Scotland has long-term, fairly ambitious targets to reduce CO2 emissions, every extra unit of emissions that come from the aviation sector mean the rest of the economy needs to work much harder to counteract those emissions and keep us on track. How much aviation increase do you think is affordable within our carbon budgets?
Well, I think one of the interesting features, your point is well made. In terms of the international travelling consumer and the airline industry, the biggest issue in the airline industry is greening the industry. And there have been huge steps made. If you look at the fuel use per passenger today versus 10 years back and all the rest of it, there has been great progress made. I'm sure we could debate as to what extent that's enough, etc.
Well,
but
the same thing
know,
is
they're
true
making
of,
much
the same thing is true of road traffic, but the overall emissions have increased because the level increases.
That.
So you know we can't rely on that as a way of. I'm asking how much do you think we can afford to increase emissions and have the rest of the economy carry the extra weight from the aviation sector?
Well, I think what I would say is that at this pace of change in the aviation industry, I think there's, of all the transport industries, they really are working very hard to green their product. In terms of the consumer, the international consumer, I think the international consumer is showing all the signs that they're pleased with the progress and worrying a little less about that as they travel. In the end of the day, though, I think it will make it is a different. It makes a difference which market we're talking about. When you have to travel over water, as opposed to the UK market, where obviously there are different alternatives, I think it does make a difference.
You can't put a figure on it, then.
I don't think I can put a figure on it.
In which case, isn't it a little reckless to take away a restraining factor if that's what you think APD is, until we know what the consequences are going to be?
Well, in the end of the day. For many of the markets, and as I say, it depends the specific market, but for medium and long-haul markets, frankly, people are going to be flying, and we want to encourage people to come and to come and see us.
Regardless of how much harder the rest of the economy needs to work to counteract those emissions.
Well, that is appreciated, but our job is to try and encourage people to come and to come from around the world, and appreciate there is that issue, but we do want people to come and see us, and that's the game we're in. That's our job.
Well, maybe at least the Scottish Government should be able to answer the question before we approve the policy change.
Also on air travel, I think Gordon MacDonald.
Just before I go on to my question, just on Patrick's point, with more direct flights rather than going through the London hub, not resolve part of the problem that Patrick's raising?
Yeah, it depends. It depends the market, obviously. I mean, you notice I'm talking medium and long haul markets. Mm. The short haul situation in terms of European in particular is very competitive and works well. And capacity is strong. Ryanair and EasyJet, as an example, work very hard to work at full capacity, which helps as well. So it is market against market, but one of the key trends that we're seeing this now, it links to the digital debate, it actually links to the transport debate as well, is the consequence of alliances and networks. And as digital continues to develop, we will see, in the end of the day, big business follows big money, and a bigger issue for Scottish tourism will continue to be how the big business community, be they airlines, hotels, etc., work in teams and alliances and networks to their own advantage, but potentially to our advantage too, if we're well plugged into them.
My question was about your point you raised earlier about the importance of the London airports to the tourism market. Yeah. Obviously, over the last 10, 15 years, Edinburgh and Glasgow Airport have developed links with other hubs.
Exactly. I'm
thinking about Istanbul, Schiphol, Dubai, Doha, Charles de Gaulle, etc. Are they as equal importance to the London hubs, and do they provide a greater opportunity for growth?
Well, yeah, I mean, we worked very hard. Malcolm could talk for the next 8 hours on how we're working up our hub strategy, etc. You're exactly right. It's probably more profound than that, though. I mean, if I was to take you to Australia, and if you were to take the Australian market and look at it 15 years ago, if you were traveling from Australia to Scotland, you were flying to London, basically. Whereas today, if you're flying from Australia to Scotland, you're very unlikely to go anywhere near London. There's one airline flying one flight a day, being British Airways. Whichever other routing you're going to take, you're not going to go through London. And we're seeing that kind of profound shift as we work around the world. But if you go to Australia, you'll still speak to people, and they'll tell you, well, obviously, if I'm going to Scotland, I'm going to London. So, I mean, we're talking about profound shift. We need to ensure that not just the links are in place, but the communication is in place to ensure that people know how to get to us easily and at best value.
Okay. Right, one last supplementary on air travel, and then we need to move on. Liz MacDonald.
You talked about the importance of the London hub, and clearly there are decisions in relation to that will be taken elsewhere. Is there anything the Scottish Government should be doing, or that Visit Scotland would want to see being done about those links?
Well, to be fair, we work very closely with the Scottish Government team, who are excellent, I know as soon as we talk about London, it immediately, you think we're opening the runway debate, and actually it is broader in terms of competition and airline movements. I mean, if you take Virgin as an example, they've now withdrawn from Scotland. When they came, they were half owned by Singapore Airlines, which is a Star Alliance partner, and Singapore Airlines sold that shareholding to Delta, and that was a shift in their strategy. In a sense, we play in a game where in aviation with very large companies, multinational companies in large airline networks, and we need to be flexible. And to if you go back, and I've told you, I'm sure here before, when we lost the BMI link into the Star Alliance network in London, that was a profound situation. There's 20 million people using that terminal today. And there isn't now an airline flying out of Terminal 2 to Scotland. So these are market shifts that we need to take into account, but they are very important for Scotland, both in terms of the actual physical links and also in terms of the pricing models.
Just for the record, what is Visit Scotland's view, if it has one, on the runway issue?
We obviously are looking to encourage as much access to Scotland as best possible. There is an issue in London, and if the capacity issues ease, we would be delighted to see that. We don't favour any specific runway, and where, but there is a clear issue in London, which we've articulated this morning, which in the short term is our greatest anxiousness. But clearly, a lot of people, of course, do, when they come to the UK, want to visit other parts of the UK, and London in particular, and come to Scotland, and their ease of access to that is important.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we'll move on. Bruce Crawford.
Thanks, Commissioner. The house is a bit for good reason, but can I just bring us back to the issue of hard cash and value for money? Because, at the end of the day, how you're spending Scotland's purse is... Yeah. We'll make the decision of how much budget you get and how successful you are. And by all accounts, we're heading into a very tight settlement period again. Your figures tell us, and I know you've spoken about this before, Mike, that for every pound you get, that you get £20 back in the Scottish economy. Can you just tell us a bit about the methodology you use for that purpose and how that compares with Visit Britain? I think that would be helpful. I'd then like to ask a very quick question about budget numbers, Convener.
Okay, I'll let Malcolm do that.
Okay, the current way of measuring the return on that investment is that we measure the additionality. So simply put, that is money that was spent by visitors to the country when they have been influenced by Visit Scotland's activity. So if they were coming anyway or thought they were coming, we discount that. So these are people who've actually been convinced by the activity that they've seen to come to the country. And that gives us an additionality figure. Now, there are other ways of doing it, and I know we've been working with the Scottish Government to look at that in terms of GVA and what the impact then would be on jobs. And the methodology around that has been agreed, so we'll be able to report in another fashion as well in terms of the amount of gross economic activity generated, how that translates then into what they'd call new money, and what that means in terms of GVA and the number of jobs that are dependent. So the methodology is robust. It's used by Visit Britain, use the same methodology in terms of getting to additionality in GVA. The London and Partners use the same methodology, and Visit Wales likewise. So we're doing exactly what the others do for comparable purposes. I think, if I may be correct, that Visit Britain report generally about 8-1, I think, return on their activity.
Well, it depends. I mean, the answer to your question in some senses is it depends the targeting of the market. Are you going for low-hanging fruit? Are you going for emerging markets? And it depends the competency of the campaign. A 20-1 average is very much the kind of market average for a national tourism organisation doing a well-researched campaign. I think the point that is perhaps more pertinent is, of course, Scottish tourism is minuscule in global terms. And if you're thinking, well, okay, so we give you a pound and you can get £20 back into the economy, even in VAT, as, of course, Scotland's going to be receiving some of its VAT directly, well, that's great. We'll just give you more money, give us more money back. The issue is that every national tourism organisation that has a good product and puts together a good campaign can perform at this kind of level. And so the competition is becoming far greater. If you take America, America didn't have a formalized marketing national tourism organization approach. They now have Discover America with vast resources who are extremely competent. And when you have an America coming into the marketplace, as an example, then, you know, you're up against some serious competition. So the difficulty with having such great returns is that everyone is now chasing them in times that government money is tight. So we're going to have to continue to fight harder, frankly, with the resources that we have.
Taking that as read in terms of numbers, I think it says the public purse is getting good return based on the methodology that's used. The year to June was very good in terms of the figures. Obviously had Commonwealth Games Ryder Cup in it. 15's better than we expected in the circumstances. But the challenges out there, whether that's the continuing issue of the strength of the pound, the issues around the general sluggishness in Western economies, and I said some of this yesterday, another meeting I was at, but also now the impact of the tragic and terrible events in places like Egypt and Paris and the impact that might have in the industry, and we don't know the outcome of that yet. And the fact that actually if you look at your budget and take the £5 million out, of that budget, which is now stripped out for this year, and if you get the same as 15-16, you're £9 million down than where you were previously. Is that really enough to be doing the job you need to do? I think that's the hard question I've got in my head, and what this committee at the end of the day needs to recommend to the government.
Well, you're...
It might be difficult for a government agency to reflect on that, but I'd like to try anyway.
Well, yeah, you're asking me to ask if we would like more money, and we would like more money. But I think one of the things that perhaps is significant that we maybe haven't explored fully is that we are judged to be a national tourism organization like Visit This, Visit That, and Visit the Other around the world, and it's true. If you take Visit Britain does international marketing. They really don't do an awful lot else. If you take Visit Scotland, we do an awful lot else in terms of information provision, quality assurance, et cetera, et cetera. But in the end of the day, it is the hardcore marketing of Scotland, in particular across the UK and internationally, that these guys consistently tell us we need to be doing first and foremost. And I think that is going to continue to be the thrust, and I think that's right and proper. So we're doing everything we possibly can to find every penny of resource to market Scotland as hard as we can. And as the competition, I think, becomes ever stiffer, we will continue to have that as our mantra.
Yeah, I mean, I would just sort of support Mike in saying I think, you know, the world is a much smaller place and the competition is that much more tough to get. So you have to be out there. And, you know, yes, you know, the international markets do prove, you know, greater spend, and there is, that's where the prize is, and it costs money to get there. So stepping back or even staying still, I mean, certainly the industry's view would be the wrong thing to do, and, you know, put more into it and actually try and maximise your return, but at least just, you know, fend off the competition.
These words are issues, you need to get out there, and the £1 for every £20 back for every pound spent suggests that if we got out there a bit more, with a bit more leverage, we would actually get more money coming back into the economy, create more jobs. So I know nobody's said, yes, give it, you can't put a figure on this, but I think what the general tone I'm getting is that if there was at least a standstill and hopefully an uplift in your budget, that would help us get more jobs in the economy, because that's what really this is all about.
Well, I think that's right. You noted that I mentioned Visit Britain pretty quick in the CSR discussion. Well, it's a complicated situation in terms of Visit Britain's role, but I mean, you note in the papers, we focus our international marketing as best we can in the United States and France and Germany, a bit in Australia. And for the rest of the world, we heavily depend on Visit Britain. And Visit Britain's network of offices, for instance, came down from about 36 to about 21, if I remember rightly, when the last major restructure came. And if the, you know, there's great anxiousness in the industry that they're going to face some tough choices post the CSR settlement next week. And in turn, that will bring some tough issues and questions for us. I mean, we have one single member of staff based abroad, in Toronto, as it happens, and that gent focuses in business tourism. Well, we're heavily dependent on the Visit Britain network of 21 offices, and that itself may bring something of a refocusing if those challenges come to bear.
Thank you.
I've got other members who want to come in. I just want to ask a follow-up about something you mentioned just a moment ago, Dr. Cantlay, about quality assurance. I think you said that the Visit Britain were not involved in that. If budgets are going to be tighter, does Visit Scotland still need to be in quality assurance, particularly now we're in an era of TripAdvisor and a whole range of other private sector competitors in that market? Is that something you still need to be in?
Well, I'll let Malcolm answer that, but beforehand, I will remind Marc that I came to... I mean, one of the benefits of having the STA as well connected into the industry as it is, was I came to speak to them and said, look, you guys need to be clearer, not about what you want, but about what you don't want, because the immediate answer to your question is the industry say we must have a quality assurance scheme, and we must, and we must, and we must. And actually, we're going to go through a period where we are going to have to make some choices, and that's inevitable.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely true. And I think, you know, protecting the brand and protecting the reputation is key, and the quality assurance scheme does provide that channel. And, you know, whatever you say, the consumer will still look for a badge of appeal, and we all have seen varying reviews on TripAdvisor, and you can choose to believe what you want to believe. But it reaffirms, I think, a commitment to professionalism. You know, without a scheme, I think we're very exposed. And, you know, nobody's mentioned Airbnb yet, but, you know, there is the largest growing hotel company in the world. With no quality assurance, with no regulation, with no contribution being paid to the tax. But that's the consumer choice, admittedly. But can we be assured that their experience of Scotland in an Airbnb site or in a non-quality assured property will, you know, deliver against the actual aspirations of our strategy?
Just coming back to your original question, The budget, in budgetary terms, it washes its face. I mean, it costs 1.3 million to deliver. There's 1.2 million that we bring in terms of revenue. I think the wider question is more about what does quality actually mean, and what will it mean in 5 years' time or in 10 years' time, particularly because you have real-time assessments taking place, as you mentioned, with the likes of TripAdvisor. We know from research, not just our research, but the European Tourism Council research and UNWTO as well, that at the moment, people still use the two. So they will look at the comments posted, but they also want the reassurance that there is an independent, authentic assessment that is out there, so they can balance, if you like, the extremes in terms of the postings. For me, what might be quite interesting, though, and what I've asked my team to look at, is how do you combine, in a digital age, the requirement for quality? Is it only about attractions and only about accommodation, or is it actually about a destination? And if it's about a destination, do you look around a net promoter score? So it's the whole total holistic experience that someone gets. It's not just about the accommodation side. So that's work that we're going to be looking at and taking forward.
Okay, thank you. All right, I think Lewis McDonald was next.
Yeah, just going back to Mark Crothall's points at the beginning about looking for support for destination management and destination development, and my Cantlay recounting where we were 5 years ago and how that has changed in terms of who's responsible for what. I wonder how both SDA and Visit Scotland see that rolling out going forward, and what, given that governments have to make choices about priorities, and there are clearly, we've already had some discussion around that, how significant is destination management in the bigger picture, and what is the right relationship between central government as opposed to local government and destination management organisations?
It's a good question. I think, you know, there is a survey and a bit of work that was done by a working group, as you know, within the industry, across looking at the destinations and the disparity around support funding for the cities and the rural communities. And, you know, you have Glasgow Local Authority, you know, putting 5 million into the tourism project, Edinburgh 1 million, Aberdeen a lot less. But the rural DMOs, and particularly the islands as well, where they do a lot more than just the marketing, are very dependent on having some form of assured stability to enable, you know, and I think give better confidence to the industry than to put the hand in their pocket and actually part fund it. I mean, nobody is saying that the industry couldn't be doing more to, you know, contribute towards the funding of a DMO. But there are some really great examples where there has been some support funding where it has actually, you know, accelerated industry commitment. If you look at the Argyll and Isles Tourism Partnership, that model is superb, and they're really being very, very progressive in not just the marketing activity, but developing the local economy by, you know, really bringing other businesses, not just pure tourism businesses, into the mix. And, you know, the further more rural you go, of course, the greater the working the percentage of population are in our industry. So when the STA first sort of came to the fore, although we are only four, we have a council of 40 sectoral groups, many of which are destination bodies, and they're active and they're voluntary. And every one of those has managed to grow their own organisation in size and scale because there's a common framework that's been adopted. And there is aspiration to do that. But there is a need to be able to provide at least a baseline support to what we identify as probably being 35 to 40 destinations, not what originally were perhaps the 300 tourism groups that we believe there were, or were led to believe there were at the 2-3 years ago. So shrunken down, and there are key pockets there, St Andrews, and as I say, the Hebrides, Argyll, Oban, outdoor capital.
I think it's often said in government, if you wait long enough, you end up back where you started. And in a sense, where we've been in tourism is a good example of that. If you look back to the kind of late 70s, early 80s, we had many, 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 many organizations all over the country. Destination groups and trade organizations that needed some form of coordination. And then we had area tourist boards, 35 or so, and it was decided there was too many, and we'd have 14, and then it was decided we wouldn't have any, and we'd, you know, and then suddenly we ended up with literally hundreds of little groups all over the country. And that was the environment that certainly I remember coming into 2010. And a lot of debate about who does the marketing, who's responsible for what, etc. And how we try to help was to explain, in the end of the day, these groups are the product in that location. And the stronger they can, you know, as a group of businesses, can define the product, be clear what they are and what they want, then the easier it is for Visit Scotland in particular to take that product to market. Because in many senses, we're the customer. And we've got all the research and data on the customer, be that in London or Paris or New York or whatever. And that made things much easier, that everyone understands kind of where we are and what we're doing. And how destinations have evolved, you know, you can actually draw a flow chart as to how a new destination organization works its way through. They're there to do marketing, and then they do some things, realize this works and that doesn't. And they very often tend to spend more time actually focusing on getting stronger in terms of defining their product and where they need help going forward. And they've all evolved in different ways, but I think it's going well. And I think there's far more comfort as to who does what these days. And I think that will evolve further. I think we'll see a bit more consolidation. And I think the groups will be better able to define where they need government help and where they don't.
Can I
factor back in there.
Yeah.
I think, you know, specifically we have a national framework, the Tourism 2020 strategy as the national framework. That framework has now been adopted across 25 to 30 different destination groups and in some of the sectoral groups, which gives us a huge amount of strength in going back to trying to refine and make efficiencies that much better, and where we can choose or where we identify the need for investment that much simpler, so there's not lots of reinvention of the wheel. But localizing those strategies is a key, and actually, you know, that's where a key role, key part of a destination group remit is to actually bring those businesses who aren't yet connected, who aren't the 7,000 plus who are yet to get on the VisitScotland.com site and get them online and get them joined up. The DMO and the role of the destination group, is that's by far probably the most important role that we see them doing, and in addition to a bit of support to the marketing efforts of Visit Scotland as well. But they're key, but not everywhere.
I think that's the point. I think I hear from both of you, you both think DMOs should have the ability to access public funding, but neither of you is looking for a formalised, comprehensive structure of public support.
We've been, especially with the themed years, etc., we have this concept of the growth fund there to help, where it works both ways in a sense. I mean, we are encouraging these destinations to partake in the campaign so we can bolster our activity, but it is a route for them to access marketing funds, as it were, or event funding, etc. And I think that's worked well. Mm.
We have a paper in which looks at the Sport Scotland model, which obviously allows a pot of money to be drawn down against for those destinations that can basically deliver on key projects and initiatives. But, you know, ultimately, you want the industry to contribute and support. When we entered into the spirit of the Tourism Scotland 2020, you know, a key message to the industry: this isn't about there's a strategy, public purse, pay for it. You know, it's a two-way thing. But I come back to getting the support from the industry will come if they know that there is an assured continuity of resource, etc., to enable that destination to, you know, be sustainable in the long term. And a lot of it at the moment is fairly up and down. And I think, you know, deciding on where any sort of support award or funding gets made should be measured by a criteria of, do you actually deliver, and actually are you giving us return on that investment? So rather than just a blanket approach of saying, well, you know, there's £10,000 or £50,000 to 35, 40 destinations across the piece, because it doesn't work that way.
Thanks very much.
Okay, I've got two members who have been extremely patient, but I want to take a very brief supplementary from Gordon MacDonald, who was...
Thanks very much. It was just the point you made, Mike, about Visit Britain's offices being reduced across the world, and I'm just wondering if there was an alternative in the Scottish Enterprise Network of 30-odd offices that they've got in some key markets. And, you know, I realise there might be budget implications for doing that, but would that be an alternative, given that both of yous want to grow the Scottish economy?
Well, let me be clear. The drop from 36 to 21 happened some time back, so it's potentially the next, you know, whether there need to be further cuts in light of the CSR, and we don't know that. We take every opportunity to use anyone at our we can utilise when we're abroad, and that would be Visit Britain, but it's certainly the SDI offices abroad. It's also the best auspices of FCO and basically anyone who can help. I suppose the best way to differentiate it is that where Visit Britain is very important to us is their link to the specific trade partners, but particularly the consumer in that marketplace. So in a sense, Visit Scotland's focus is very much the consumer. SDI's focus is more what we would call B2B, business to business, than B2C, which is what we do. So in a sense, the two organisations out in the international field do different jobs. But I can assure you, whenever we are, whatever we do, we work very closely together.
Okay, thank you. Richard Lyle.
Okay, thank you for giving that.
Good morning.
the first question I want is really a quick question. I've got two questions, but it's one that just came into my head. If you go to most European countries now, they charge a tourist tax. We have a situation where local government is complaining of the very little funding. So would we encourage in Scotland a tourist tax that local councils could get that funding? Yes or no?
No.
Okay, I'll move on to my second question.
Very quickly, yes or no?
I knew that one wouldn't fly.
Maybe I will. Maybe I'll try and interpret that a little. I suppose the issue is, whatever you call it, rates, commercial rate, a tourist retailer or a hotel will tell you they have a tourist tax. It's called their commercial rates bill. The issue for me that I'm particularly anxious about, in particular when we've seen the exchange rates moving as they are, is we talk a lot about quality in Scotland, and that's entirely appropriate, but we must always bear in mind value. And value against our competition, and in the end of the day, it's a hotel bill as far as the customer is concerned. So we must think about where we are and how we're trying to fund things. We need to think about the consumer and how Scotland rates in terms of value, and make sure Scotland is always good value to our visiting customer.
Yeah, I'd agree with you, best value. Right, can I move on to how you do your marketing, advertising, and campaigning? You have 20 million people are on your website. You're looking to working with TripAdvisor to reach 500 million people. You are currently doing a campaign of value 360,000 in the Borders in order to promote the Borders Railway. You're doing international campaigns in North America, Germany, France, and Australia. But the one I like is you're targeting your campaigns at the best prospects. What are the best prospects? China, you know, if you come on to the look at, you know, on the television, a lot of Chinese are now visiting other countries. Massive market. Do you sit down in the room one day and decide where your campaign money is going to be spent that year, or do you do it monthly or weekly, or just look at? And also, I realise that you also have attracting conferences throughout the world. So how do you decide how you campaign or target your campaigns?
Sounds like one of our board meetings.
I'll come along one day.
Please do, and bring the answers with you. I think the easiest thing to say is the easiest prospects are those who've been to Scotland already. That's the first thing, because you've already gone through the difficulty of selling to them, and they've been able to experience the product and hopefully have gone away with a great experience. We have, at Visit Scotland, we have a database of about 8.5 million people, which we utilise, and that's very much about the returning market. And that's across numerous countries. It's not just the UK. It will be international markets as well. The other markets, so those who've never been to Scotland, what we do is we go through a market prioritisation exercise, which is based on expenditure by visitor, propensity or likelihood to come and visit Scotland, so you can benchmark yourself against some of our competition. The most notable one is about an hour away by flight, so don't have to mention them. We then look at, you know, what they're looking for. Do we have the product fit to meet those requirements? That then takes us into what's the size of the market. So in Germany, for example, it could be about, you know, young travellers, but who are interested in culture and events, etc. So we're able to break that down. We build that up, a picture of what they look like and how, you know, the sort of things that they're interested in. How close are they to, airport destinations? So things like, you know, Nordrhein-Westfalen, we'd have 27 million people. So we don't go after Germany, we go after specific regions. Or in North America, we'd go after the eastern seaboard, because we know the propensity to fly to Scotland's greater. When we talk about China, I don't talk about China, I talk about Shanghai as an area, because we don't have the resources to do big countries. No one has. And even in my previous days with Guinness, it took us 10 years before we rolled out of Atlanta and places like that, because it's such a big and expensive market to get into. So it's a very focused way of doing it. It takes quite a lot of work and effort, and we just went through a repeat of the exercise in the last 9 months. And the market priorities for us are, as you articulated, you know, it's Europe, near Europe, it's North America, there's some tactical opportunities out in Australia and Canada, UK by far and away the biggest market, and then there's some sort of Team Scotland activity in the BRIC markets, and I think, you know, that's about focus there. And we looked at what will 10 years' time look like in terms of trends. And you know what? The top 10 were still going to be the same top 10. So, yes, there will be changes. You know, and someone mentioned earlier events that's happened in Europe just recently. But we have to prepare for all of that. You know, the one thing about tourism, there's always something happens. And certainly in my time, I mean, the very first year I joined, 9/11 took place, and then you had all sorts of crises, you know, year on year. So you kind of prepare, you know, for moving and being agile enough to switch your resources into areas where they have to go. And it's a bit like I always refer to it as having a balanced portfolio of shares. Some will go up, some will go down, and never, you know, are they all at the same level at the same time.
I think there's another feature, which is, if we're blunt about it, is just reality. In terms of many other competing destinations, we don't have the hardcore marketing resource to compete in the same way. So if you take an America as an example, from time to time, say, well, why Ireland do a great job in America? Why doesn't Scotland do, you know, why is not Scotland not so obvious? Well, the truth is Ireland have many, many, many times more money to spend in that market than we do. But we're cute at how we do things, and we focus on opportunities like Scotland Week as a classic example. And in particular, we focus on our USPs. And this is so crucial for Scottish tourism going forward, because we have unique features, be it golf or whisky, to exploit. But the one thing that we haven't discussed this morning that's so important to appreciate is that we have, in a sense, if not a new USP, a more widely appreciated USP, which has become very prominent and clear over the last couple of years, in particular through the Commonwealth Games, particularly Commonwealth Games, Ryder Cup and the Homecoming Programme, and that is the Scottish people. Because out of all the features that attract people to come to a destination, the people bit is absolutely crucial. And, you know, we've talked for long enough about Scottish tourism being everybody's business in Scotland, and we've never been closer to that. When it comes to these big events, everybody gets out to be part of that experience and to help to provide that ultimate welcome to our visitors, and that has rocked right across the world and is one of our strongest assets. So we play to our strengths, and I think we're very good at doing that, and we have some unique strengths to play to.
Thank you, Kinnear.
I noticed from the written evidence that Visit Scotland speaks specifically about delivering the growth agenda. And you will, of course, know that the Scottish Government now talks not just about growth, but sustainable growth, in particular emphasis on the importance of fair work. So can I ask what meetings you've had with John Swinney and Rosanna Cunningham to address these questions inside your sector?
Yeah, I suppose probably a definition, firstly, of how we see inclusive growth. I mean, for us, we've talked about digital inclusion. I think that's absolutely fundamental. Also, geographic inclusion. You know, Scotland is, you know, the tourism industry stretches all the way from Shetland all the way down to the borders. It's absolutely vital in fragile communities in rural areas and in the islands. So it's something that we've been doing for quite some time, perhaps not under that banner and you know, perhaps not as overt as it is at the moment. But that to me is very important. It's also about the skills agenda and young people, trying to get them into the industry and seeing it as a career that they can develop and progress with. And not just, you know, as a kind of last gasp attempt at finding some employment. I mean, it's much more than that. And all of these skills that they'll learn are transferable. They can take them whether it's within Scotland or overseas. And I think it's also about how do we work with the communities as well. That's quite important to us. Because just going back to your DMO discussion that you were having, the one thing about the local communities and the people in them is that they bring the knowledge and the energy and the passion. And that's what we need when we talk about the content that we are marketing with the likes of TripAdvisor or Google or whoever it happens to be. So we have to work with people in those communities and give them a sense of ownership. And I think that's been the biggest change over the last few years, is people can see that they actually own this industry, they're part of this industry, and we're actually only there to help support them and help their communities. In terms of specifically around the living wage, we ourselves have applied for accreditation, and I think it is important, you know, to show leadership in that area. I don't think morally or ethically anyone has a problem with the living wage or the business pledge. But I think we all recognise that in this particular industry, you know, there are one or two sort of issues that we need to address to be able to get some of the smaller businesses on board.
So in terms of specific meetings with Cabinet Secretaries to establish targets for you, have there been any meetings, and what demands have been placed on you in terms of addressing the question of fair pay?
Well, they're not being addressed. We haven't been given any specific targets. What we've been asked to do is to work with the industry to make sure that we're able to address some of the issues that the some of the players in the industry may well have. And I know Marc and the STA have had quite a lot, and BHA have had quite a bit of representation and meetings with.
Meetings with Cabinet Secretary to outline to you how they think their commitment to inclusive growth and fair work would be expressed through a growth industry like the tourism industry.
Well, I think the strategic forum has been the specific, I'm not going to explain the whole context of the strategic forum, but with other enterprise agencies, we've heard from all those relevant ministers as to their hopes and aspirations in this field. In terms of direct specific targets, I'm not sure we've specifically...
There are no milestones. Yeah. I mean, I think the issue is that we know that your sector is labour intensive. Our figure shows that 72% of employees in 2014 were being paid below the living wage. We know that across the United Kingdom, 40% of employers rely on or use zero-hours contracts. Across all sectors, that's only 11%. So these are two areas which, in terms of inclusive growth in a sector like yours, is going to be critical in making a difference in terms of fair work. You have more people who are in jobs which may be defined as low-paid and unstable. So what specific things are you now planning to do in order to address how critical your sector is in terms of improving the fair work landscape across Scotland? Yep.
There are a number of key factors here for the industry. Nobody's, I think, from an industry's perspective, nobody is actually saying that they don't see and endorse the principles of a living wage. However, you know, it is well documented that the blend and of the workforce is very varied, and the challenge for many is to balance the bottom line in some cases. So we have made our sort of views felt on those issues around, without having to go into the increasing price again and coming back to this competitiveness, what can we do to maybe offset some of the incremental cost that a living wage will bring. As Malcolm alluded to, you know, one of our key actions in the skills investment plan is to raise the profile of the sector, to try and enhance it as a career of choice. We need to remove some of the stigma of it being a default industry and it's a poorly paid industry. We've got some very highly paid personnel in our industry, and we accelerate career opportunities quite rapidly. But for some of the big players out there, the impact of the new national wage coming will mean that there is risk to some of those players in terms of meeting their covenant. It could stifle investment for people who are actually genuinely looking to and capable of growing their business. So there has to be a bit of give and take, and certainly the Licensed Trade Association is the one that is probably suffering more so than most, and it needs volume to come through. But there is, you know, a lot of, there's some work streams going on around productivity and how can we actually look to address the leadership piece in a stronger sense to maybe negate some of the issues around being dependent on a low-paid workforce and readdress the balance of the workforce within the actual business itself. But the principles of it, we've gone on record as the industry is saying absolutely we support it because we are an industry that aspires to be seen to be, you know, an industry that has professionals and attracts the right people in.
I just wonder if there's a connection between something being regarded. I mean, I agree with you, there's an issue around attitudes towards retail or to the hospitality industry. But part of that is informed by the fact that people are less likely to be in reasonably paid jobs and are less likely to have job security, surely. And I accept that you recognise the principle of it, but for Visit Scotland as an economic agency, what are you doing? What are you asking of government to support you moving towards that? You know, the industry is trying to manage it. What should we be asking the Scottish Government to make support to the sector conditional upon perhaps showing there's progress around the living wage, there's progress around the less use of 0 hours contract? And that's not a question, in a sense, for the industry. It is a question for the agency. And I was concerned earlier when you talked about, you almost seem to define a cut in APD as by definition being more competitive. Surely there is an anxiety that if you have that concept of competitiveness, what is to stop the competition then being around wages and conditions? How does the government support the industry to actually shift from that being the competition to being around quality of delivery and the nature of how people deal with the public or whatever?
Yeah, well, you know, I think it's a huge issue. Your point is well made. There is a huge amount of discussion in the industry, I mean, a huge amount of discussion as to how the industry responds to this. And this doesn't answer your question, but it compounds it in a sense. There is also the huge issue of encouraging young people to join the industry. And, you know, in terms of what we're doing, I was in a college last week speaking to about 100 students who are busy working in relevant courses. And there was a fundamental anxiousness that there aren't the jobs available, you know, despite the pay rates and all that, there just aren't the jobs available. And actually, you know, in the last couple of years, we've seen 14,000-15,000 jobs created in the industry. Those messages aren't coming through. So as an industry, and indeed at government and ourselves and our other agencies, we've got a huge job to do to encourage Scots and young Scots in particular that this is an industry with all kinds of opportunities. We need to be better expressing them and giving good examples, I think, as to why it's an industry that they will, you know, it's a good industry to go into and they will do well in.
So what incentives can we create then to encourage and support employers to offer a better standard of pay and more job security? Because that feels to me that is, if government is saying they have a strategy for fair work which is connected to growth, and you're a growth agency, what are your responsibilities? What could you write into your quality assurance assessments? What incentives could we create around the benefits of being part of the Scottish Business Pledge so that the industry recognises that? I mean, what is the incentive just now to a business to say, you know what, I'm going to buck the trend, I'm not going to have 72% of employees in the living wage? What conversations are taking place now to help the industry by the government? Otherwise, it feels to me as the government has said they've got this importance of fair work, but as far as the biggest sector where there's a problem, there's not even a dialogue about how you could support people to move towards the government's agenda.
Well, I think there's certainly the dialogue. You should deal with the quality assurance issue.
Well, firstly, there's work going on across all the agencies to look at, you know, what is the evidence base for the industry that they would like to see. So is it things like reduced retention costs, increased productivity? So they're trying to build, if you like, a business case around it. Now, whether that's successful or not, we'll see, but that's what's been pulled together. Secondly,
and that will go to government? when it's done?
Well, I presume so. At the moment, it's being commissioned, so it's not finalised yet. But so they need to pull that evidence together. The second part is about the quality assurance scheme. The quality assurance scheme is not a mandatory scheme; it's actually a voluntary scheme, and therefore, one of the issues that you might well find is that actually to make something compulsory in that, because there's no subsidy in the scheme, so people are actually paying to be part of it, you may well find that they decide they don't want to be part of the scheme, and then you end up with an unintended consequence, which is actually the whole focus around quality and value for money is actually eroded. Sure. So we have to look through all of those things. I mean, I take on board your point about how do we get the industry to see that this is a good thing to do, and how will it benefit their business? And that, I think, is still very much in its infancy.
So in the budget, would it be reasonable to say that Visit Scotland, as a growth agency, it would be useful to you to have an identified amount of money, which is not about making the quality assurance thing move from voluntary to compulsory, but it's creating an incentive for people to be good employers, if that's in the context of a government that says that's what they want?
Be Visit Scotland. I mean, I think...
You're the growth agency for the sector.
But business support...
If there's a conditionality upon your support, would it be reasonable to make that the condition? And would it be reasonable for government to fund you to be able to do that if they want to match up not just growth, but with sustainable growth in a sector where it's the best example of this whole issue of what might be defined as poor quality work because of low pay and job insecurity?
The point I was going to make is I don't think it's whether it's Visit Scotland per se or whether it's the public sector in general. If it's about business support, we need to make sure that the mechanisms are in place. Whether Visit Scotland is the agency that delivers that business support or it is just an agency that supports that and signposts to it, at this stage, I don't think that's the most important thing. I think it is actually understanding what does business need to get over the barrier in terms of implementation.
But it would be reasonable to say that that your industry is where this is most prevalent, and that any government who wants to address that prevalence of low pay and job insecurity should be working with you as the growth agency. Otherwise, one might suspect that actually we have a complete separation of the growth strategy from any concerns about fair work. I just want to know how you think you bring these two things together.
I suppose what I'm trying to do is avoid creating another agency that delivers business support. We've already talked about simplification and making it easy for businesses to access where they can get support. And that's the point I'm making, is that if it's on a single portal, it doesn't actually matter whether it's Business Gateway, Scottish Enterprise, Visit Scotland. The fact is that it is there and it's easy to find. And I guess that's what I'm saying.
Well, one of the issues we have with an industry that is, so many different players and so many small players is communication. And there are growing examples of businesses that are responding to this well. We're better able today to explain it and express it. And I mean, we're just about to go out into the winter program of Visit Scotland STA. We'll all be out going around the industry, and I can assure you, it's a key topic. It's a key topic where we're linking. Well, here's what this business has done and that business has done across this whole agenda, and that's definitely working. It's certainly catching the mood, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I don't think it's here, and actually the business has to respond to the minimum wage and changing the pay scales. So looking at productivity, looking at what you have to do to ensure that you attract it. And there is, going back to this aspiration of trying to profile and make sure that this industry is seen as a career of choice, and more importantly, offers real progression. It's here to stay. Tourism is never going to go away. It's here for good. And it's also, we use more and more often and draw out the... if you're in the digital arena, if you're an engineer, you are in the tourism industry. There are multiple of different career options and pathways that you could go down.
For me personally, and I think a number of my colleagues would share the same view, the issue and the challenge for the change in perception of our industry starts in the primary schools. It actually needs to be presented by the teaching workforce that actually tourism is more than just hotel keeping or working behind a bar. It's a much broader opportunity. And when you start to attract the skill, you will invest in those people, and you can drive your productivity, then so you will want to reward and pay. And there are a number of other, of course, of our businesses who, you know, we have a seasonal workforce and it's transient and it will move. And that's the nature of the beast globally in the tourism world. But the ones that you want to invest in, there is absolute commitment to do that. And I think, you know, the industry will continue to work through and look at the case studies and examples of where businesses have actually made that shift, and retention of workforce is one. And actually, how does that sort of deliver on your bottom line?
If there was one thing that government should do to support your aspiration for, you know, the sector to be regarded more highly, and I think we would accept surely that low pay and job insecurity adds to that sense that it's not a sector you want to go into. What is the one thing that government could do to break that cycle? Because we can't wait around and hope that people will just take a risk for going to this sector, which is devalued on low pay and job insecurity, in the hope that because they're there, it will improve. Yeah. How do you turn it around the other way? What can government do to help you?
Well, just answers. You made a couple of comments there that, you know, it's perceived as low paid and devalued. Actually, I personally think that the perception of the tourism industry is in a lot better place than it was many moons ago. And I think, you know, going back to the likes of these major events and things that we host, and you see what actually the tourism sector delivers, has actually raised the appeal of the industry in a big way. I was 35 plus 40 years as an operator, peeling potatoes, having knives thrown at me by a chef when I was 16, and I've worked in 9 countries around the world in the industry. So, you know, and I don't see the industry today in its being tarnished or considered as an industry not to go into.
With respect, I already accepted that. You said that there was an issue about how you retain people because of people's perception. I agree with you. If you look at the common
I think how we retain,
this,
yes.
But even if there is a huge change, people are more likely to go into it. The fact of the matter is 72% of employees were below the living wage, and 40% of employers in this sector, as opposed to 11% across all sectors, use 0 hours contracts. We can understand why that's happened. We want the sector to work. I'm asking you, if the Scottish Government's in favour of inclusive growth and fair pay, what can they do to help you as an industry to make that shift?
Well, I think first and foremost, you know, we've spoken about business rates and things like that. I think some of those overheads and costs that the industry are actually having to incur at the moment need to be revisited and relaxed, so we can go through a transient change to get to, you know, a more balanced approach in pay rate. I think there are some top-line challenges, licensed trade, change in regulation around drink drive. We've got to drive more volume into the actual businesses to allow that bottom line to grow, and gradually then move those up. So it's looking at, you know, not just one particular thing. I think the whole package of how a business in our industry actually operates at the moment is something that's, you know, that conversation needs to continue. And it has started, and I think, you know, there is an acceptance that, you know, we are a sector that has a challenge, but there is, you know, a genuine desire and I suppose a willingness on all sides to sit down and try and find those solutions. But in the short term, for some businesses, it is going to be a very, very big problem.
Okay. I think one of the other issues that we're trying to explain is, in particular this year after 2015, this was a year that the industry should have taken one of its traditional, if not severe, significant downturns. It just is the way it goes. And that hasn't happened. And one of the core reasons that hasn't happened is because the government and the country got behind the events of 2014 to give us the kick to get through that. Now, actually, if I'm honest about it, I can't remember in the industry going back in time when government involvement or public involvement to that extent, and it's, you know, it was it goes beyond the specific government of the day. It was the whole people of Scotland drove the machine through 2014,
And it has had a profound effect in terms of protecting the industry through difficult period in 15 and hopefully set us up. And in the end of the day, when it comes to these businesses, it is about bottom line profitability and all the different bits of bed tax and all the rest of it all plugs in. So in the conversations we're having around the industry through this winter, we are trying to explain them, well, look how more confident you are now than you were at the start of the year. Look at the storm we've just weathered, and now the weather's getting better. We're in good shape to tackle the next period and to address these issues. And we'll see how we do this winter, but I'm confident we're making progress.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I appreciate we're a bit behind the clock. I promised a last question or two to Patrick Harvey. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener. It's on a similar subject, but I'll try to be brief. I would have shared the expectation and the hope to hear more concrete actions being taken to drive up participation in the Fair Work agenda. But you've talked about the large number of small businesses in this sector, which I see as a strength. You've talked about the need for young people to see this not just as any old employment, but progression and something that they can have a long-term future in. There's a connection between the two, because where are those next small businesses going to come from if young people don't feel that they've got a future in this industry, particularly in communities where hospitality and tourism employers might be the only or amongst the only opportunities they've got. The UK government, though, is taking a very different approach. Instead of promoting a living wage, which is calculated to give people what they need to live with dignity, they're cutting the tax credits, and they're imposing an additional upper age band on effectively the minimum wage. Now, we've heard in earlier sessions arguments that many, many employers may be driven by that toward more use of zero-hours contracts, more use of casualisation of labour in order to make sure that they can keep employing people at the lower age bands and that they will close down the opportunities for younger people as they start to approach that 25-year threshold. Is there a danger that particularly those kinds of communities where hospitality and tourism are the major opportunities, we're going to see over the next few years more incentive for those young people to get out while they can before they start seeing those opportunities closed down? And what can the Scottish Government do to address that, not necessarily in terms of your budgets, but areas like tax and welfare, which it is going to get some opportunity to make measures in over the next few years? Oh. I said I would try to be brief, but it wasn't easy.
Yeah, I'm afraid I don't have a magic wand, yeah. But I take on board exactly what you say. It's for the industry as a whole. It is a potential barrier to growth and into employment, and it is not something that we would like to see, because it's counter to everything that we've just been talking about in terms of trying to get young people into meaningful work and give them a career and a career path. So I think it's actually related slightly to the previous discussion that we've had. And rather than come up with some immediate knee-jerk response to that, I think I'd quite like to take that away and think about it.
That once this 25-year age band on the minimum wage comes in, we're going to be looking at an upper age band on the minimum wage, which is getting on for double what the 16, 17-year-old age band is. Yeah. Isn't that going to increase the incentive for very many employers who find that their bottom line is difficult to these people out, or get rid of people, or shift people onto 0 hours contracts so they're not employing them as much when they get into those older age categories and employ more people who are younger? Isn't there a real danger that we squeeze off the future of some of those communities?
I'll give you my personal opinion. I would be concerned that was an outcome, but I think maybe...
No, I share the view, and I think, you know, knowing many of the 21,000 businesses... Well, and when we have the conversations, we had 9,000 people through our Tourism Week program last year. And I think there's a recognition that, you know, you have to have mature, a mature workforce balanced with a young workforce as well.
And if you squeeze out to pay the lower wage and then just rely on a younger generation coming through, immediately your quality concern comes into play. Do you then actually end up with a reputation that isn't as good as you want it to be? So it swings and roundabouts. I haven't come across anybody who have sort of said, well, that's it, I'm removing the old and I'll just work with a 16, 17-year-old workforce on zero-hour contracts. I think anybody who chooses to do that would be very foolish. So I'm not convinced that will happen by a long shot.
For me, the interesting thing that I see in the industry from your point and actually Joanne's point as well is that I hear discussion in an industry appreciating these are significant issues, but actually as an industry we haven't actually addressed the issue before that, which is the simple spark and inspiration to even look at it as a sector. And it's people like you, Mr. Crothall, mentioning pot rooms and whatever. Mm-hmm. I would like a job in the hospitality industry, and I'm cooking and whatever. And there's what has happened over the course of the last few years is the industry has expanded so in terms of I have a run of slides as to the different types of jobs that are available in the industry that people obviously just hadn't thought. Well, that's key. So these issues are absolutely key, and I accept that. But as an industry, we've got more to do, I think, fundamentally, to catch the mood that it's a sector that's worthy of looking at, and there are exciting jobs to do, as well as the issues in terms of pay and remuneration.
And also the aspect that, as Marc quite rightly said, this is an industry, we've been doing it for 200 years, we'll be doing it for the next 200 years. It's a safe industry in terms of job employment, but I take the points entirely. It has to be properly remunerated and be seen to be so.
Sorry, I thought the reference to pot rooms was a call for changing drug policy. There could be opportunities there.
In those days, it was. Yeah.
It's a whole different debate, yeah. Mr. Harvey.
I can assure you, in some of the kitchens in Africa,
it was like that. But I think, we had this discussion around tourism as a badge. The careers are a career in marketing, a career in accountancy, a career in carpentry. Those are all trades and skills that are actually make up the business that we run. And it's positioning the sector as providing those opportunities, guiding, adventure, the adventure piece, etc. There is a whole raft of opportunities. And for the younger generation, it's opening up those doors and getting them to realize that what's presented to them is not just this, you failed your exams, you're going to go into the still room and be shouted at, or you're going to go and work behind a pub behind a bar. And nothing against barmen, because they do a great job, and I hope they do a good job tonight.
As UK welfare changes push more of the people working in those jobs further into poverty, that there is a real danger that they have to conclude getting out of this industry is their only option. That's something that we really need to take seriously.
Okay. Thank you. This has been a slightly longer session than we expected, but we've covered a lot of ground. Can I, on behalf of the committee, thank you all for coming along. And I think, Dr. Cantlay, this might well be your last appearance before the committee, before you demit office. So can I say on behalf of the committee members how much we've appreciated your engagement as chair of Visit Scotland over the last number of years.
Thank you. And
thank you for your chairmanship.
It is the best job in the world, so it's a privilege.
And at that, we will now suspend and go into private session.